joining us once again. Today we are going to talk about the modern data warehouse using Azure. Today's session is the second part. So in case you don't know who am I'm Nilesh Kule, and here are my social coordinates. I'm one of the active Microsoft Most Valuable Professional or MVP for Microsoft Azure area. So let's look at the agenda. In the last session, we covered what are the different components of modern data warehouse. We looked at the data lake architecture, and we also looked at the storage account and Azure Data Factory. In today's session, we are going to talk about the next part, which is the Azure Databricks. And we will also look at how we can integrate some of the security practices using Azure Key Vault. And in the next one, we will move over to the Azure SQL Data Warehouse. So in today's part two, our focus would be Databricks and the Key Vault. Let's quickly look at the summary of the previous one, where we looked at data lake storage and Azure Data Factory. So in the data lake storage or ADLS, we looked at the main features, which are the petabyte scale storage. It is similar to if you worked on Amazon, the S3, which gives you object storage. The advantage with ADLS is we also have something called as hierarchical namespace, which allows us to do operations more on the level of, let's say, folders or file systems, and we get actual file system representation of the data and not just a logical separation in terms of the files and the names of the files. And we also looked at some of the main features of Azure Data Factory or ADF. We looked at how it can be used as a cloud-only ETL tool, or it can also be used as a hybrid ETL tool, where it can connect to multiple types of data sources, be it on-premise. It could be things like structured data, semi-structured data. And in the example, we looked at the code-free UI, where I pulled in data from one of the publicly available data sets on GitHub, and we used it to store as a CSV file as well as JSON file. And we also briefly looked at the monitoring and management aspect of the data factory. While we were closing the session, there were some things which I wanted to show. So let me quickly go back to Data Factory and show some of the things that I missed or I could not complete last time. The first thing is the monitoring part. So if you remember, when we log in into the Data Factory, this is the user interface we are provided with, where we have the option to author the pipelines or data sets and build integration pipelines. We also have the option to monitor, and the current screen where we are looking is the manage part, where we manage different services, linked services, and also things like trigger and global parameters. So let's go into the monitoring aspect and look at some of the pipelines which have run in the past. So I'm currently looking at the last 30 days of pipelines, and let's look at the first one. So this one was ran on 18th. This did the copy CSV part. If I click on that, you can see that I get the activity run details. And when I hover over, let me zoom in a little bit. If I hover over at the activity, so this pipeline, it can contain multiple activities. In this particular case, there is only one activity. So it is showing me only one activity at the bottom. So I can look at what were the inputs which were given to this activity. I can look at what were the outputs, and I can also look at some of the details. This is one of the good features which I like about Data Factory and the details it provides in the monitoring. So you can look here that I was using a HTTP connection as my input data source, and then I was looking at storing this data into the data lake storage. So it showed us here how much data was written. It's a very minuscule data in this case, just about 8 MB, but still. We get a higher level overview in terms of how much data got written as part of this particular pipeline execution, how many files were read, how many files got written, what were the peak connection, what was the throughput, and also in terms of costing. So how much time it took in terms of the duration for execution, and then from the point of how much charge we will get or how much cost would incur for running this pipeline, we can see that it used the data integration units as 4, and there was only one parallel copy. We can control this to an extent. So if we are using the self-hosted runtime or autoresolver runtime, let me go into the copy CSV pipeline and this activity here. we can see that in the settings part, there is an option to specify how many integration units we want. And we will also get number of data integration units for copy activity, approximate charge. So this is like a guidance figure, how much would be charged for executing. And then if we know that our activity takes more than, let's say, 2 or 4 data integration units, we can specify this here. I've left it as auto, which means that based on the number of files or the volume of data, this will scale automatically. So that was about the data factory that I wanted to show. Now let's move on to the current topic, or today's topic, about Azure Databricks. So what is Azure Databricks? Databricks is a company which maintains the code base for Apache Spark, and they also provide analytics platform. So from the point of Azure Databricks, it's a unified analytics platform which gives capabilities like, if you look at the Databricks itself, it has integration with multiple cloud providers. So it, at the infrastructure level, it can integrate with Azure. It also integrates with other cloud providers with native integrations. It can support different data sources, like we can integrate IoT or streaming data. Cloud storage data can be integrated. Traditional Hadoop storage, like if you are having, let's say, MapR, Cloudera, or Hortonworks-based Hadoop installations, we can integrate that as well. And if you are talking about Azure, it can also work with the HD Insight, which is similar to the Hortonworks on Azure. And then other sources like data warehouse. It also has a very reliable way of connecting different data pipelines. So we can do transactions, indexing, and this is done using Apache Spark, which is the framework, or which is a project, which is quite popular for its in-memory processing. Spark is known for its processing power, and it's you can find Spark integrations with almost most of the leading tools nowadays and platforms. Spark has also features where it can provide you libraries for machine learning and AI related things, and it does this on a distributed platform. The best part about Spark is it works distributed, and it tries to reduce the overhead of doing things in the disk level. So we will look at some of the features of Spark in the next section. So all these pre-packaged ML frameworks, they come built in with the Databricks runtime. So what we get is a fully packaged Spark as a service on cloud or on your infrastructure. And we don't have to worry about setting up the cluster. We don't have to worry about creating those integrations and connections between different nodes. This is all managed by Databricks. And it gives us, on top of that, management features, like we get notebooks, we get jobs features, we get monitoring, things around security and compliance can also be integrated on top of this Databricks runtime. So we will look at all this during today's session. Apart from this, Databricks also released a project recently, about, I think, 6 months back. This is called Delta Lake. So Delta Lake is a storage layer which gives the asset transactions on Spark. If you look at the previous versions, like if we are doing big data processing on, let's say, Hadoop-based processing with Hortonworks or Cloudera, we might be using HDFS as our storage layer, and we might be using something like Hive. And these, they don't have by default the capabilities to do asset transactions. So the recent versions of Hive has support for asset transactions, but what Delta Lake does is it takes it to a next level. And this is built into the framework called as Delta Lake. This supports streaming as well as batch processing. And if you remember from the last session, we talked about zoning our data lake. So we had different sections for the ingestion layer or raw zone, then the process zone, and then finally the aggregated or curated zone. In this case, Delta Lake likes to refer it as bronze zone, silver zone, and gold zone. So the terminology might be different, but it's essentially having these different zones for different type of data. And this again integrates with the cloud sources as well as the HDFS integration is there. And we can integrate Delta with analytical and machine learning processing. Some of the other features of Delta includes schema enforcement. So we can say that if we are ingesting data into a table, it can enforce the schema and it can identify bad records, and it will take care of not ingesting records which don't meet the minimum data quality levels. There is also a feature called as time travel, where let's say we are continuously integrating data into our Delta Lake and we want to look at a snapshot of data at a particular point in time in the past. So I can say my data as of today, let's say I get every day a snapshot or new changes into my table, but I want to see what was the state of my data 2 days back. So using the time travel feature, I can look at that snapshot of a couple of days back. So some of these features and the other capabilities of Delta are available in this link which I provided. Now let's go and look at some of the benefits of using Spark. Why Spark is so important. Last week we had this session after my part one, where we looked at how the SQL Server 2019 has Spark integration and how it can support Spark. So it's not just that we are using Spark for big data processing only. Even in RDBMS like SQL Server, now we are trying to integrate Spark. So some of the reasons why Spark is very popular, in especially in terms of data processing, is because of its speed. There is a saying, or there is this claim by the Databricks or Spark community, that it can run 100 times faster as compared to MapReduce. And the reason for that is it tries to do everything in memory. We know that every time we have to interface with the disk, there is that IO overhead. And by eliminating that IO overhead, Spark tries to do these computations across the nodes in your cluster. And it can work with these collections using distributed APIs. So it offers a very easy to use API. It has support for multiple languages. So by default, it supports Java, Scala. You have Python support, R, and off late, there is also support for C Sharp. Nowadays, we also find notebooks which are written in C Sharp with Spark as the runtime. It also has more than 100 of operators, and it offers a unified execution engine. So it gives us high-level libraries to support SQL queries, streaming, machine learning, graph processing. Before the advent of Spark, if we wanted to do, let's say, big data processing for SQL data or CSV type of data, we had to do MapReduce. If we wanted to do streaming, there was Flume or some other tool to be used. For machine learning, there was other libraries. So what Spark tried to do was to bring all these different libraries or different modes of processing into a unified layer. And best of all, it runs everywhere. So it runs on Hadoop, it can run standalone, it can run on these engines like Mesos, Kubernetes, and now it also runs on the cloud. So back when Spark became popular, or when it was gaining popularity, this particular post was very much responsible, I would say, for that. It broke the record for the largest sorting, large-scale sorting, which is called as the terabyte sort. So if you look at the statistics here, the MapReduce, it was taking on a 2100 node 72 minutes to do 1 terabyte of sort, or just about 102 terabytes. The same kind of processing with just 206 nodes, Spark managed to do that in 23 minutes. So that was the kind of benchmark it set. And this benchmark is as of 2014. Over the years, this performance has only grown better and better. So let's look at some of the reasons, or how does Spark manage to achieve this. In terms of the APIs itself, or the different components that Spark supports, there is the support for dataset, data frame, and what it calls as the resilient distributed disk, or RDDs. So what this RDDs allows us to do is it gives us data lineage as well as resiliency. So let's say there is a processing which is going on. Spark has initiated some executors and processes, and data processing is running. And one of the nodes where this processing is going is impacted. Something goes wrong with that node. Spark will automatically identify that this particular node has gone bad, and it will schedule that workload on some other available node. So it will automatically try to build its resiliency into the data processing. And it does all this by distributing the data as a collection. So if you look at the diagram here, Spark has what is called as the Spark context, which is the entry point to your Spark application. So this is like your main method. And there is this Spark driver, which is like your master slave kind of architecture. So if we look at master, Spark driver is like your master, and this will spawn multiple jobs which are called as executors. And the actual processing would happen on different nodes, which is done using these executors. So we have we were having different kinds of APIs or different kinds of entry points sometime back. So if you were working with just pure RDDs, there was this Spark context. If you were working with SQL data, there was SQL context. If you were working with streaming, there was a streaming context. This again has been unified recently. Recently, in a sense, it's been more than 2 years. This has been unified into one single entry point, which is called as Spark session now. And then there are transformations and actions. So transformations are the lazy operations. If you work with Java 8, for example, or if you work with C Sharp, these languages, they have this feature where it can do lazy evaluation. So we just build a series of operations, and until action is called or until a terminal operation is called, nothing happens. It just builds a graph of activities. So that is what these transformations are also doing. And then action is something that actually triggers the processing. So let's look at some of the common transformations. We have things like map, flat map, filter, distinct, and the others which are mentioned here. So these are pretty much similar to Java 8 operators as well. If we have worked with Java 8 streams, we have similar constructs there as well. And then in terms of the actions, we have things which will give us the final result, like doing a count or counting by value, taking a certain number of records, doing a top operation, or writing the results to an external data store, like saving it as a file or writing it to a database. So with that, I think that's the end of theory on Spark. Let's go into the demo mode and see how we can use this feature with Databricks. So I will start by going into how to create a Databricks cluster. I've created one, but again, to show the process of getting this started, I'll show how to get Azure Databricks. So similar to all other resources that we create, we go into the Azure portal and we select the type of Azure Databricks service. This is a managed offering. We would select which is the subscription, then the resource group. So let me just pick one here. And then the workspace name. So I can call this as SQL Pass SG Demo 2. And then the location. And once I have chosen this, I can choose what type of pricing tier do I want. In terms of standard, I get Apache Spark cluster and security with Azure AD. If I use the premium option, then I get advanced features like role-based access control. And there is also a trial version. So based on our needs, we can choose either a standard or premium. And then in the networking, we can choose whether we want to install it in like a public workspace, or we want to install it in our own virtual network or VNet. And then we can define the tags and create this. So I've already created this in the interest of time, because it takes some time to provision this workspace. Once I have the workspace created, I can go into the details of that. So when I click on the name of my particular workspace or Azure Databricks service, I would be presented with the similar management UI or the control plane, which we saw earlier when we were doing the ADLS as well as Data Factory. So we get these common features or common settings related to this. And then there is this launch workspace option. So launch workspace takes us into a different workspace, which is managed by Databricks. It integrates into our Azure portal, but this is a service which is built on top of the Databricks components. So what we get is the home screen, and we have the workspace option here. Let me zoom in again. We have the recent option, then there is data and the clusters. So when we come into the workspace, the first thing we would like to do is to create a cluster. Workspace is just like container, which will provide us some security features. And within that, we have the option to create multiple clusters. Let's click on create cluster here, and let's say SQL pass live demo. So in terms of the cluster types or cluster mode, we have two types of cluster. One is the standard one, the other one is high concurrency. Standard clusters are meant for regular jobs kind of clusters. If we want to have automated jobs which run, and after the job is finished, we don't really need that cluster to be up and running. So let's say I'm doing my processing every morning, or I have a processing which needs to be done every Monday of every week. And then the rest of the week, I don't really need that cluster. I can use the standard cluster. High concurrency cluster is used for machine learning or exploratory analysis kind of scenarios, where you have data scientists and data engineers working continuously on that cluster. And if I choose the high concurrency, I can also choose a pool. So instead of, it's similar to the SQL pool. So instead of creating all the resources at once, we can create a pool of resources and we can distribute those resources across the pool. So let me just select standard here. And then we have the Databricks runtime. Databricks runtime is the package which comes with the version of Scala and Spark. So we can see here that there are different versions of the Databricks runtime. The most current one is 7.2. We also have the ML version of that, which has GPU support. So when we create this cluster, the VMs which will be provisioned behind the scenes would have GPU support on them. And then we also have the option to select which version of Scala we are going to use. So let's say we can also look at the remaining ones. So you can see here that the earliest version of Scala that is available is 2.11, and Spark is 2.4.3. And the latest Spark version is 3.0 with Scala 2.12. So let's go with 7 version here. We also have the Python support. So you can see here that in this particular version of Databricks runtime 7.0, we have only support for Python 3. And then we have the autopilot or auto scaling option. So we can enable auto scaling, and we can say if there is no activity or the cluster is inactive for, let's say, 60 minutes, I want to terminate the cluster. And after that, we can choose what is the size of the worker or the master node, and what is the size for the driver node. Sorry, the driver is the master and worker is the executor nodes or the workers. So we can have different sizes. Basically, you need to have more processing power where the processing is happening. So your workers would be more in size or slightly higher in size as compared to that of the driver. Because driver is the one who is coordinating these distributed processing. So you might not need too much power or too much capacity on your driver, but a worker would require more capacity. And then we can define our range. What is the minimum number of workers and what is the maximum number of workers we want to have? And with that, we can also go into the details, advanced, and we can provide some Spark configurations. So Spark allows us to override some of the configurations. If I want to override any of the default Spark configurations, I can provide something like, if I want to use, in this case, the example is that of a cryo serializer. If I want to use cryo serializer as my default serializer for all my Spark objects, I can override the default settings here. And I can provide some environment variables. And with all those settings, we can go ahead and create the cluster. Again, in the interest of time, I have created a couple of clusters here. So let's look at the first cluster, which is the standard one. Currently, this is terminated. So let me go and start the cluster. And while it is getting started, we can also look at some of the other features that this UI provides. So for this particular cluster now, I can install additional library. I can choose from the available options, like I can upload my own jar, I can upload Python egg files or wheel files, I can store the libraries or executables in what this Databricks calls as a DBFS file system or Databricks file system. we can put the files here. We can also get it from package managers like Maven, or we can store them directly under the workspace. Then we also have the option to look at the Spark UI. So if we are running Spark, let's say in standalone mode, or if we have run Spark on, let's say Hortonworks cluster in the past, we know that Spark provides a UI using which we can see what processing happened or what were the steps that happened during the job processing. So we can look at a similar UI using this Spark UI option. We also get the logs for drivers, and we also get access to different metrics. And on the management side, we have settings using which we can control. Let's say for the individual user level, I have integration into Git. I can integrate my code or the notebooks that I create into Git or other supported source control systems directly. Right now, Azure DevOps, Bitbucket, and GitHub are supported. Then we can also define some notebook settings, like do we want to have some tips provided Spark? So automatically, like IntelliSense, you will get tips based on the steps you are executing, and other options here which are available. And then there is something called as access token. Access token is like a personal access token which we can use to integrate our cluster or Databricks workspace with other services. So I will come to this a little later when I will show the integration between the Data Factory and the Databricks cluster. So let's go back into other settings. Apart from the user, if we have the admin privilege, we can also manage the whole workspace. So if I have like the owner or the administrative privilege, I can add more users to this workspace. I can create groups. So I can create, like currently there is admins group. I can add more groups here, and I can say like a developer group or a tester or a data scientist kind of groups. I can also define settings for the storage, and then I can check at a very specific levels like clusters, pools, jobs. Do I want to enable fine-grained control access? When it comes to the tables and personal access tokens, do I also want to control those? So all this can be controlled and managed using the admin user interface. And then we also have integration and the security features. Like I can integrate with third-party services, container services, I can integrate, and I can enable or disable these settings. Like, do I want to enable exporting the notebook, for example? In some cases, you might want the users not to download any content from your notebook. In that case, you can disable the option to export your data or the contents of your notebook. So all these features are available at the admin level, and then we have some other settings here as well. Now let's look at the next feature. So let's go back to the cluster and see if it has started. It is still trying to start. I can also do same thing from, the management part. I can also do it from the edit permissions. So here I can specify who can manage my cluster. So I have created this cluster, and then I can assign, let's say I have multiple users in my workspace. Who are the admins for that cluster? Who can manage the cluster? And then at a user level, again, I can give a very fine-grained permission to say a user can attach to this cluster. So I can separate. The best part I like about Databricks is you don't create your notebooks or your processing pipelines and attach it directly to the cluster. These are two separate things. So you can have the cluster independent and your processing pipeline or your code independent. And at runtime, you can decide which cluster you want to attach it to. So I can give those kind of permissions saying a particular user, he can attach to this cluster. In terms of managing the cluster and restarting the cluster, I can also manage that part. So I can say only selected users have the permission to restart the cluster, and very few users can have the permission to manage the cluster. So now the cluster is up and running, and I had created this cluster with three nodes. So we can see the driver size is DS3v2, and the worker size is also the same here. And I created it with 7.0 version. Once I have the cluster, I can then go into my workspace. And there are two types of workspaces. One is the shared one, which is shared across all the users. And then there is user-specific workspace. So I have created some notebooks in my user-specific workspace here. Let me open the first one. So if you have worked on, let's say, Jupyter, for example, and if you're aware of the notebook concept, this is exactly similar. You get in your workspace an option to create different things. So if I go on create, I can create a library, I can create a folder, I can create a machine learning experiment, or I can create a notebook. So I've created a notebook here. And when I go to create a notebook, you will find that, let me give a name here. Sample notebook. I get a choice to choose the default language. So I can choose at this moment based on my Databricks runtime, support for Python, Scala, SQL, and R. So any of these languages can be my default language. And if I want, at this time itself, I can attach this to a cluster, or I can just leave this, and at later point of time, I can attach that to the cluster. So this particular notebook is a Scala notebook. And then inside the notebook, I have these cells. So I can just go here, click on the plus sign, and I will get a cell created. These are called as magic cells. So they are exactly similar to your Jupyter notebook. And I can create things like a markdown content here. I can put a percentage sign, and then the type of the language or the interpreter. In this case, it's Markdown. I've given the header as notebook to process CSV data. And then I can define, since it's a Scala notebook, the default language, the variables or the elements of my Scala program. So I'm creating three different variables here. One is for the storage account, the other one is for file system, and the third one is for directory name. So for this example, instead of using the COVID dataset, I will use the MovieLens dataset. The COVID dataset that I used last time was very small, I think less than 20 MB, and it's not really suitable for big data processing. So what I've done here is I'm using the MovieLens dataset, which is one of the publicly available dataset, and I'm using, there are different options here. You have a small set which contains 100,000 ratings, there are 3,600 tags. It's about movies, ratings, and let me show you what are the different categories it has. It has the genome score, there are genome tags, there are links to the different movies, the movies details itself, movie ratings, and the tags. So these are the different files available as CSV files in that data set. And the one related to ratings is about 725 MB. And the one for genome is about 400 MB in size. So that's one of the reason why I chose this slightly bigger file size or data set. Again, by no means 700 MB is big data related, but just to give you a sense of what we can achieve with Spark, I've used a slightly bigger data set here. So in this, what I'm doing is, once I have these variables defined, I want to access this data. Now this data is stored in my data lake storage account, which I created in the last session. So there is my blob containers or the file system. The name of the file system is MLLatest, and there is a folder called MovieLens inside this MLLatest file system, and I have deposited all these files inside that. So in order to connect to that, I need to provide the storage account key. This is one option using which the Databricks or Spark can connect, Azure Databricks can connect to ADLS. There is also a service principal method. We can also use OAuth. This is the simplest method which is available. That's why I've used this. But in a more complex and production scenario, you might want to use service principal, which gives you better control. Because if you give the storage account access key, it's like you're giving keys to your whole storage account to everybody. So I would recommend that in the references, I've given the other options which are available. So try to use that. But for the purpose of this demo, we will use the storage account key. And then we access this using the ABFS secure file system. So this is a driver or protocol which is optimized for data lake storage Gen 2. And the native integration is there between the Databricks and ADLS. So this makes the integration between the Databricks and our storage layer much more faster or performant. Then we have this syntax where we provide what is the file system name, what is the storage account name, and which is the directory we want to source our data from. So in order to get the data or read the data using Spark, this is what I was saying earlier, that if you have worked on C# Link or let's say Java 8 API, you will find this similar, the Streams API of Java or the Fluent interface kind of syntax. So I start with Spark, I say I want to read the data. I provide different options like does my data file, which is ratings.csv here, does it have a header? And do I need to infer the schema? So if there is a header, Spark can automatically infer the schema based on the header information. So let me just clear all this state and results and run this, run the complete thing. So while it is running, let's go into the next steps. Once I have this, the result of this would be Spark would read this into a data frame, which is like a distributed table, or I get a collection of data rows. Then I can run show command on that to show, I think by default it shows 20 records. And then I can also use within the Databricks notebook, the display function, which will show all the information. So the default show will give me only 20 records, whereas display will give me more than 20 records. The default for display is 1,000 rows. So I can see my data here, and then I can also do things like count. This is the terminal operator or the action which I talked earlier. Now what I want to do is I want to show some of the performance benefits we get by using the modern day files file types. Like there is the Parquet file system or file type, there is ORC. These are the row columnar or columnar storage, where instead of storing the data as rows, they store it in columns. And by using things like compression and the techniques of compression for different data types, these file types, they are able to reduce the amount of data or the disk usage. So let me start by writing this in different formats. So I'm reading the complete ratings.csv file, which is about 750 MB, and then I write it. So for writing, I use that reference of the data frame, which I got earlier. I use the write method, and I want to overwrite. If the file exists, I will get an error here because of the way Spark works. So in the mode, I'm giving the mode as overwrite, and I specify the file type as CSV. So again, I'm writing it back as CSV itself for some performance optimizations or to do the comparisons. And then I provide the same syntax to access that file system in my ADLS. The additional part here is I have given a folder name or directory name, which is CSV output. Same way, I go and write the data in Parquet format. So you see here that I'm not changing my reference. My data frame reference still remains the same. It is just that I'm writing it in multiple formats. We started with CSV, then we changed the mode or the type of file to Parquet here, and I'm writing it into a folder called Parquet output. Then for the ORC, I'm writing it into a folder called ORC output. And we also store it into the Delta format. This is the Databricks Delta, which I talked when we introduced the Databricks service. So this is written into Delta output. And on this data frame that I got initially, I can also do things like filtering. So I got all the records, I wrote all those records to these different file formats. Now I want to see a filtered set of records. So I can use a function dot filter, and I can give my condition here. So I know that in my data set, there is a column called as rating and it has numeric values. So I want to filter all those records or all those ratings which are greater than or equal to 3. So you can see that we read a CSV file, but we are treating it as a collection here. And we are able to do filtering just like we would do in Java or in C#. This is also similar in Python. So if you were using the data frames in Python, you would have something similar. So the API of Spark, because it supports these multiple languages, it would be more or less the same. The functions would be similar. The syntax of the language would be slightly different. And finally, I'm also doing a count here. So when I ran all of this, this ran successfully. So you can see that the final output here, it took about 5.68 seconds just for getting this count. And each of these cells, they also have the timing. How much time did it take to write these operations? Now let's move on to the second part of this. I've written this data and I want to read that data. So let me go into the workspace again, and I have the querying part or the query performance part here. So I'm using the same initial steps in order to connect to my ADLS storage. I have those three variables, the file system name, folder name, and the directory name. And then I connect using my storage account key. Let's start by reading the complete CSV file. So again, let's go clear everything. And let's run the complete notebook. And what I would like to do here is to see how much time does it take to read this data in different formats. So I'm reading the CSV data here. Then on that CSV data frame, I'm doing a filter for all those ratings which are greater than 4. And finally, I'm also doing some sort of aggregation. So I do a grouping on the user ID, and I want to see who are the users with most ratings here. I do a count, and then order by descending count and the rating, I'm going to group those users to find who is the user with most ratings. And similarly, I do the same three-step process: read the data, then select the specific column, user ID and rating, having this rating filter, and then the aggregation for Parquet. Then I do the same thing for ORC and Delta. So what I want to show here is the amount of time it takes for these activities. So let's start by looking at the first one, CSV file. So you see here that it took 8 seconds to read, then it took 0.4 seconds to do this filtering. And for the aggregation, it took about 7.9 seconds. So closely about 7 seconds. When it came to Parquet, it took 0.66 seconds to read the same data from the disk. Then it took 0.3 seconds to do the filter. Actually, filter doesn't matter here because it's kind of, it's not an action. It's a transformation, so it won't actually trigger until somebody calls an action on that. So that action happens in the next step. So that is the part we should be looking at. So for Parquet, it took again around 9 seconds to aggregate. And in ORC, to read the data, it took less than a second. It's the same data. So if you remember when we wrote the data, it's same 750 MB data written in different format, but you see the difference in terms of reading. This is because the way it's stored and the way it's compressed. And then in terms of doing the aggregation, it took 38 seconds and then the Delta part. So when it came to Delta, it took 0.5 seconds to read. And for the aggregation, it took about 2.5 seconds. So we see the difference in reading the data as well as aggregating the data based on the different type of file that we are using. I would like to also show how does this happen. And in the Databricks, also in Spark, we have this option to look at the resource usage. So let's start with CSV, the first one. So if I look at these Spark jobs here, I can go and view what exactly happened. And I can look at the DAG, or what is called as the directed acrylic graph, what steps it took to come to this particular stage. And it will show me what exactly happened in different stages. So you can see here that in the second 22 stage, there is the input data, which is 725 MB. So whole of that CSV file is read here. And if I go into the next one, let's look at the ORC one. Let me just minimize this. So you can see that ORC picked up only 46.4 MB, so less than 50 MB. This is because we have that filtering. We are filtering based on the rating value, as well as there is this partition pruning happening and the predicate pushdown. In this case, I have not partitioned the data. I also have another notebook where if I go into the partitioned one, I can define a partition. So when I store the data, I can say use one of the columns in my data set as the partition key. So let's go into the CSV. I'm using the same partition key everywhere. So I read the same data like earlier, but while writing, say for example in CSV, I'm saying partition this by rating. So what would happen is when it is getting written, we can see, let's look at delta partition. There would be a physical folder which is created, like the name of the column which we are using for partitioning and the value of the column. So physically data would be stored in these folders and directories, and that way it would be able to put only the data for that particular rating in that folder. So when we read this data, Spark is optimized to read only the partition which we are requesting. So if I say get me all the data which is having rating greater than 3, it would ignore all the partitions which are like 1 or 0.5, 1.5, all those below 3, and it will filter only the partitions which are relevant here. So that is another performance benefit we get by using the partitioning feature. The next thing I wanted to show you was in the clusters about the auto scaling. So I tried to run something which was taking more resources. I started with initially 3 clusters or 3 nodes, and then I gave the max size as 5, and I tried to run a machine learning algorithm yesterday night, and you can see here. So it is auto scaling from 2 up to 5 workers. So it realized here that I think this is today itself, not yesterday. Yeah. In this case, what happened is because I enabled auto scaling, the Databricks runtime is able to identify that 2 nodes or 3 nodes are not sufficient for my processing, and it automatically scaled it to 5 nodes. And same way, when the resizing was completed and when the processing was completed and these 5 nodes were no longer required, it is able to scale down again. And when nothing is required, it will terminate. If I give the termination time, it can also terminate the whole cluster. So we can do this processing only when required and then terminate the whole cluster. This is another good feature of the Databricks runtime and the Databricks clusters. So with that, I think I covered most of the parts. Let me show you the attachment part where I can attach the notebook. That's one thing I didn't show. So I have 2 clusters. If you look at the clusters earlier, there are 2 clusters which are currently available. One is running, which is the current one, and the other one, high concurrency, is currently shut down. So what I can do is this particular notebook currently is attached to the running cluster. I can say run it on the other one. So that is the separation I get in terms of the compute and the way the processing is or the code is written. I can decide at runtime which cluster I want to target to. The last thing I would like to show is how this can integrate with our complete pipeline in the modern data warehouse. So let's say I build this processing and I want to schedule this processing. There are multiple options using which I can schedule. First one is using the Databricks itself or Azure Databricks, where I have the option to schedule jobs. So I can create a job here and I can choose what kind of job I want. So let's say scheduled movie rating analysis, and I can select either a notebook. If I want a jar, I can select a jar as well. So I can, it's not just the notebooks or the interactive way we can deploy things on the Databricks. If I have a jar which is created, let's say you have been working on Hortonworks or Cloudera and you have built a lot of jars for your existing projects, these can be migrated here and deployed onto the Azure Databricks. And we can set that jar location which we want to run. So in our case, we will use the notebooks approach, and I can select, let's say, the query partitioned performance. This is the notebook I want to run. I can pass the parameters if I want. If my notebooks takes any parameters, input parameters, I can define them as key value pairs here. And I can also pass a JSON string for those same parameters. And I can schedule. So this would be like a cron schedule. I can define every hour, every day, every minute, or every month, whatever is my schedule that I want to schedule this job to run. The other option is this can be triggered from Data Factory. I can integrate Databricks and Data Factory together. So for that purpose, I need to generate that PAT token. So I can go here under the user setting and generate a new token. And using that token, I can link the Databricks cluster to the Data Factory. So let me, I've already generated this token. So let me just show what comes up when you create a token. I need to give some comment. I can define the lifetime of this token as well. I can say this is valid for 90 days. And after that, that token will be automatically recycled. So this token, once it is generated, I will get a one-time token value or PAT token, which I need to store somewhere. So for that purpose, I'm using Azure Key Vault. So if I go back into our different services, Azure Key Vault is the key vault. So it provides different services where we can securely store keys, secrets, and certificates. And if you have used something like HashiCorp, this is similar to that, where our secure data, like the connection strings, if we have SSL certificates, those can be stored securely in the key vault, and we can define in the access control who can access the key vault. So we can have the role-based access to say a particular service or a particular identity has access to the key vault. And then on top of that, even if you have the access to the key vault, you still need to have access to perform specific operations. So the kind of operations that we have is the permissions for keys, the permissions for secrets, and permissions for the certificates. So I can say who has access to do like a get operation, list operation, update, create, delete, or all these, whatever is listed. In case of keys, same way for secrets, I can define what level of information or what level of access can be granted to a particular user or service principal. So I've already gone ahead and given these permissions to the identity which is associated to my Databricks instance, and I've created two secrets here. The first one I already used, which is the storage account key. So if you look at my notebook here, and if you look at this key, this is the key I'm using, storage account key, which is the actual storage account key from my ADLS storage account. So again, I'm not exposing the key anywhere. No one knows what is the value, maybe except for one admin or one individual. This again can be automated. I can build a pipeline if it is part of CI/CD to rotate my storage account keys and automatically update that key in this key vault. So in a very secure manner, I am connecting to my storage account here. I'm not exposing any of the secrets. And same way, I'm doing it for the PAT token. So I've taken the PAT token value and stored it as a secret value inside the key. Okay, somebody is singing. Thank you. Okay, so we had that.
Sorry, Nilesh, do you mind unmuting yourself? I just mute everyone else. Sorry about that. Nilesh, sorry, you're still mute. Nilesh? Nilesh?
Hello, can
there
you hear
you
me?
go. Sorry about that. I had to mute everyone because there was some noise coming in. Sorry about that.
I'll just need a couple more minutes. I'm almost done. Okay. So if you remember from the last session on the data factory, every time we want to connect to an external service, we need to create a link service. So here I have created a link service to Azure Databricks. And in the connection settings, since it is linked to my Azure subscription, I can choose that workspace for the Databricks and I can provide the access token. So the access token can be picked up from this Azure Key Vault, and I can select which Key Vault service I want, what is the name of the secret, and then I will be also able to choose the cluster on which I want to schedule my workload or I want to run the pipeline. I can create a new cluster or I can use the existing cluster. So currently I have those two existing clusters, so I can choose one of them. Let me just show this access token based approach. Something happened in the settings, but when setting this up, I will not save these settings. I will be able to see the existing clusters and I can choose those clusters. So once I have already created this connection in my pipeline, I can go and create a pipeline where I have I can directly choose from Databricks. Do I want to run a notebook? Do I want to run jar? Or do I want to run Python? So I have chosen notebook option here. Just drag and drop this activity. And in the configuration, I choose which service I want to use. And in the settings, I need to specify which notebook I want to run. So the same notebook, which is available in my workspace, I can choose that. And then if I want to pass any additional libraries, any parameters, I can pass them here and I can add a trigger. I can schedule this to run on a schedule basis. This we already saw last time. If you want to create a schedule trigger, how to create it. So I will get the options to choose. And that way I can trigger from the data factory some jobs or some notebooks to run on schedule basis on the Azure Databricks. So with that, let's go back to the presentation. So we looked at all these things. We looked at how to create the Databricks cluster, the Databricks runtime, and the support for different management features. We looked at how to investigate the amount of input and output data that is used for each of the tasks or each of the jobs. We also looked at this timeline and the DAG, which is generated by Spark. In terms of performance, this is what I try to show, like what is the performance for non-partitioned data using CSV file, how much time does it take to load, and in case of partitioned data, I didn't run the partition notebook, but it is similar. And then in terms of aggregation, how does different files types they perform when we aggregate the data. We also looked at the Key Vault, the different ways in which we can use the Key Vault. So in summary, what Databricks provides us is a very collaborative Spark-based analytical service. It gives us different types of clusters, automated one, interactive one, the pools as well. We can also auto scale, and we can also have this fine-grained access controls on who can attach the notebooks, who can run the notebooks, and admin kind of features. So in terms of references, I've provided some references here to the Azure Databricks. There are two types of Databricks documentation available. One which is purely linked with Microsoft Azure, and there is also independent documentation provided by Databricks. So I've given links to both of these, and then the secret scope which I used, Apache Spark, as well as the MovieLens dataset. If you like using the learning paths of Microsoft Docs. There is Data Engineering with Azure Databricks, which is available. You can refer to this. And that's all from my side. These are the things where you can find me on social media, and feel free to connect. I think that's it, Pio.
Awesome session.
Questions?
I have one, because you showed the performance between the different type of data types, right? So yeah. from that we saw Parquet perform the best among the three, right? Is there a specific scenario for using ORC, Delta, or Avro, or is it does it always hold true that Parquet performs better no matter how no matter the data size and data types?
It depends on the type of data you're processing. So Parquet is very well integrated with Spark, and that's why we see that the performance of Parquet is better. So let me just go back to the slide. But you also have things which are, like, if you're coming from Hortonworks background, when Hortonworks and Cloudera were separate, they put a lot of effort in making ORC better. So if you already have, let's say, Hortonworks cluster on-premise, or you're using something like HD Insight, you might have better performance with ORC. The compression in ORC is slightly better compared to that of Parquet, but the performance of both these are more or less similar. It depends, in my opinion, the type of data also you have, like the compression which will be applied on individual columns. If you have a lot of textual data as compared to a lot of numeric data, you will see different compression rate and you will see different performance as well. So the Parquet ORC, these are quite popular. Delta is based on Parquet itself. So Delta is like a storage layer which Databricks has built. They provide easy scaffolding around their runtime, or the Delta project, which is their open source. It is using by default Parquet as a storage behind the scenes. And Parquet also has integration with other things. Like if you're using streaming, I think most of the people, they prefer to use Parquet. So it would depend on your end-to-end use case. What kind of data are you really working with?
Yeah, Nilesh, it's Aro here. I'm really amazing presentation, the demo. I have two simple questions for you.
Yeah.
The one question is like, for the Azure Databricks, right? Can we use CLI like command line interface or PowerShell for automation? Is it possible?
Yes, automation is possible. So Azure Databricks, they provide you Databricks CLI itself. There is a native CLI provided by Azure Databricks. There is also the PowerShell module, which is available as part of AZ modules. So I don't remember if it is a default one or a community one, but okay. I came across recently that there is an option available in the PowerShell as well. So in my project, the current project where I'm working in my office, we are using the Databricks CLI to automate the deployment of the CI/CD pipelines using.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. Because this, because for automation perspective, is quite important to have a this thing. And second one, I just want to just cut another person. One thing, right? For the you showed about the MS Learn, right? You showed some videos about DP200. Any video content you can refer to for the community who can learn for the Udemy Pluralsight, which they can just learn on how to learn Azure Databricks.
Databricks itself has very good content. So if you go on the Databricks site, right, they have very good content. Databricks, there is also the annual event which happens, the summit, Data Summit, and there is Spark Summit, which happens annually. So you will find a lot of content on YouTube if you just search with Spark. And then Databricks on their own site, they have a lot of content related to these topics that I talked about.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Nilesh, Mandar here. Hello.
Hi.
Hello. Yeah. Hi. I have one simple question. If I'm in the Azure trial version, can I do practice for the Databricks for a trial one, Azure trial?
Yes, you get
Because
protein-based.
I tried to create a workspace a cluster, but it's giving error because I'm using the trial one, Azure trial.
I have the subscription. I'm not very sure if there is a limitation, but what you could do if you're not really dependent on Azure is you would get a community version on Databricks.
Yeah, yeah, that is okay. Yeah, community, I am able to do that. But when I use Azure trial and I try to create a, I am able to create a Azure Databricks workspace. But when I try to create a cluster, sorry, not a workspace, it gives the error because I am using the Azure trial version. That's right. So is it not supported or there is another issue?
I'm sorry, I'm not aware of this scenario. I will have to find out about it. Did you try raising a support ticket? Maybe there is some issue with the subscription and Microsoft support can help you resolve that.
Okay, okay. Yeah, I will try. Yeah, thanks. Thanks.
You can try the 14-day trial. I think that might work. There is a
No. That is not a thing. That is not a thing. I'm not talking about Azure Databricks trial version. I'm using the Azure, main Azure trial.
Yeah, yeah, I got that point. But in the main Azure itself, when you try to create the Databricks workspace, can you try the premium version, 14 days trial?
Yeah, that I tried. I have in the drop down, I have selected that 14 days Databricks trial version. And after that, I tried to create a cluster. It's giving the error, like while creating a cluster only.
Okay. That's I can put you in contact with one person. I forgot his name. I remember he had a similar issue. You can contact me on LinkedIn and I can help you connect with this guy.
Yeah, Nilesh. Thanks. Yeah, thanks. Yeah.
Thanks, Mandar. Sorry, I didn't know about this one. Yeah. Any other question?
Guys, please help to put the survey, please. So improve that, what we can improve on the other sessions, is please.
Yeah, Nilesh, one more question. Like Databricks, can you give me the real-time scenario? Like, because same thing we can do in Azure Data Factory also, right? The transformation and all that. So is it only for the big data processing we can go for the Databricks or?
That's a very good question. If you look at the Data Factory as well, the code-free approach of Azure Data Factory, in fact, uses Spark behind the scene. It is using Spark, but the control that you get when you use Databricks is much more. You have a lot of flexibility. You can't do everything using the code-free UI of Data Factory. So if you want to do advanced things, then you definitely need to look at the advanced transformations and the features provided by Spark and Databricks. So I would say it's again a question of managed services and having your own infrastructure. So what kind of control you want to have and what kind of detail you want to process, that would be a deciding factor. Databricks would work very well in terms of big data scenario. If you have very small amount of data, I would say just use Data Factory. That would give equivalent performance to you.
Yeah, thanks, Nilesh.
Yeah, thank you. Sorry, I don't want to take more time. I think we are already about 15 minutes into the next session. I'm available, so if you have any questions, please put it in the chat and I'll try to answer while the next speaker starts. Thanks, guys.